All right, so now that we've got the pseudocode kind of laid out, let's go through and actually build the program in Java. Now, by the way, this might change. This is just a template. I'm trying to figure out logically how the program's going to work. And so I've laid it out in this pseudocode, but as I get in and actually write the Java program, some of this might change. Okay, so I'm going to create a new Java class, and then I'm going to say public class, and then give it a name. So I'll call it odd even game. Okay, opening brace to say this is where the class begins, closing brace to say this is where the class ends, and then I indent to show that whatever code is coming inside those braces is part of that class, the odd even game class. Now, again, this is meant to be a review, so I'm going to go through and review a lot of stuff we've already talked about. And so the idea of public here is that this class is available for other classes to see and access. I'm giving it public access within my program. Okay? And so this is a public class. Now, the default is that it's public. So if I were to just leave this off and say class, odd even game, this program should compile and run just fine. It won't do anything because there's no main methods, like it says. But that's the default is public, but we can also type in the public if we want to. And then we have this line, public static void main string args, that we type over and over and over again, right? So a couple thoughts. First of all, remember that a program, as we talk about it in a general term, is generally made up of many classes. So one program can have many classes, and each of those individual classes can have many methods inside of them. That's the structure of how it all breaks down, right? So the main method is just a method. It's a method that goes along with this odd even game, but it's kind of a special method because we can only have one main method in all of our classes. So if we have 50 classes in our program, we can only have one main method because that's what tells Java where to begin, right? And as we break down this line, these are things that we've talked about. Public, we just talked about. There's public and private, and then there's another one called protected that we'll talk about later. But this is a public method because all the other classes need to be able to see where the main method is, right? In one given program. You're going to take all the classes that belong together with a program, bundle them together in one package, and that is what you deploy as, this is my program that I've written, my software that I've written. And so that's what I'm talking about when I say the other classes, not the other classes all over the world that everybody's ever written, but the other classes in your program that you're writing, will they be able to see this main method? And so this will be a public method. Static has to do with who the method belongs to. Does it belong to the instance of the object of the class, or does it belong to the class? And so this one's the one that's a little more confusing and probably will make more sense as you get a little further along in your programming career. But the idea is we've built over and over again. In fact, we'll need one for this program, so I'll just go ahead and build it. We're going to need to get information from the user, right? And so we import the java.util.scanner class. This is one that's sitting out in the Java system library that allows us to get input in an easy way. And by the way, this is just one way of getting input. There are other ways of getting input. So then we build an instance of the scanner by saying scanner in equals new scanner dot, or in parentheses, system dot in, right? This is creating an instance of the scanner. So we say, you know that scanner class? I want to build one of those. Just like I've mentioned it that we're building a house, and there's blueprints. Well, the blueprints aren't the house. The blueprints are the instruction, and yes, I just said blueprints. The blueprints are the instructions for how to build the house, right? So the class itself is the blueprint, and I'm saying, I want to build one of those, and I'm going to call it in. I could just as easily call this Bob and then refer to it as Bob. I can give it whatever name I want to, a lot of times we'll use in to say this is coming in from the console. Okay, so I built an instance of this, and this is just declaring the name and what type it is. This is actually building the instance, and I'm telling it I want this a scanner. I'm speaking Espanol, apparently. This is scanner. This scanner attached to the system in. That's what I want it attached to, so that when the user types something, I'm getting that information in from the scanner. We're going to, in future videos, actually attach the scanner to other things, namely files. We'll attach them to files so we can read in from a file. But this is just saying I want to read in from the system in, so I pass in the system in, and this creates a new instance of that scanner in memory that's called in. So back to where I got onto this topic, this idea of static is, does this method belong to the scanner, or does it belong to the instance of the scanner? Okay. Static means it belongs to the scanner. It goes with the class. Not having static here would mean that it belongs to the instance. Now, normally we'll want it to belong to the instance. In most cases, there are cases where we want it to belong to the class itself. And again, this is a little more advanced topic in Java. But I know you're curious about it, so I'm explaining it. That's why we have the static or non-static. Now, again, the default is that it's not static. And so if it's normally we just leave it blank if we're not going to make it static, but then we put the static keyword in if we want it to be static. And so in the case of the main method, it has to be static because it has to belong to this class in order for the program to function correctly in this case. All right. Now, what's this? Now that we understand methods a little bit better, what's being passed in is a what we call a string array. These little brackets mean array. And so when we run this program, we get passed to us a string array that we're going to call args. And this is if we're running the program and we want the user to specify some information that's coming in with it. So if we're running from the command prompt and we want the user to choose whether they want this program in English or Spanish, they could type in, run the Java program, Spanish, and then we could take these arguments that were passed in and then make a decision right off the bat. If what the user chose in the args, and we'll talk about arrays later on, but if the args position 0 said we want Spanish, then now we want to change the language and do that. So we can get, just ignore most of what I'm saying here. But the idea is that we're being passed in a little bit of information, or can be, it's optional, that the user could be passing us information when we run the program for us to make decisions. And we could use this args variable. We haven't done that. We probably won't do that. But it's there as an option. When the user runs the program, they can pass us information in for us to make decisions based on that information. Am I using, the latest Pentium processor? Am I back using a 286? I could have them type that in, and then I can make a decision of how I'm going to run the program based on that. That was a stupid example. Okay. So that's our method. Wow. If I go on explaining like this, this series of videos is going to be really long. But hopefully it's helpful to kind of go take a step back and review all this. So I say create an instance of a scanner because I'm going to need to read in some input. And then I kind of want to look at my program and decide what variables I'm going to need. I could also just start writing the program and as I need the variables, just put them in here. But I'm going to look and see. Ask the user how many games they want to play. Well, I'm going to need a variable to store how many games they want to play. So I'm going to create, and what type of information is that going to be? Well, are they going to enter a 1.5 or a 6.2? Well, no. we want to have them enter a specific number of games that is going to be an integer, and so I'll create an integer variable. Int, and what should I call it? Well, we usually want to give it kind of a descriptive name, so I'll say numGames, which represents the number of games, and I'll just set that equal to 0 to begin with. Okay, so that's keeping track of the number of games. So then for that number, I want to ask the user whether they want odd or even. So I probably need to create a variable. Now, if they're going to actually type the words odd or even, then I'm probably going to need a string variable. Not probably, I will need a string variable to store their choice of whether it's odd or even, right? So this is going to be the user, should we call it user choice, user pick, user call. Let's call it the user call. This is going to call it odd or even, and we'll just set it to blank to begin with. Again, we don't need to do this. Java's not going to yell at us if we don't do it, unless we haven't ever tried to access the variable and then we get a null in there. But that's the problem, is there's nothing in there if we don't put it in, and so that's why we always try to initialize our variables to something. Okay, so after the user's made the call for odd or even, we need them to throw an odd or even number. Well, this is going to be a different situation. This is going to be the user throw, right? So there's the user call, whether it's an odd or even, and then they're going to throw an odd or an even. And depending on what the computer threw, the number's either going to turn out odd or even, right? Hopefully this is making sense, the difference between those two variables. And if it's not, maybe I should add a comment in here saying user calls odd or even for end result. And then here I could say user throws odd or even, which will be added to the computer result to get the total. This is the longest comment ever. We normally would not want stuff running off the screen, but that's, I'll leave that. I'm using kind of a bigger font, so that doesn't help the matters. So I've got the user call and user throw. Well, now I need to have the computer throw. Okay, so I'm going to create one more string for the computer throw, let's call it. And I'll set that equal to blank. Okay, and this is going to be an odd one or even a two. Okay, so that's kind of what we've got set up. That's going to be the user's choice. Then we can make our decisions. And what else? Do we need anything else? Okay, we do need to keep track of the number of user wins and the number of computer wins. Well, again, what type of information is that? Well, that's going to be an integer. Okay, and we can have the user wins, and we'll set that equal to 0 to begin with. Again, I don't set that equal to text, because when I try to compile this, it'll yell at me and say, you can't do that. You can't put a string into an integer type. And so I need to start out with a 0. And then I'll do the same thing, an int for the computer wins, and I'll set that equal to 0 as well. And then it looks to me like we've got probably every variable that we need to. And so we've got kind of the structure of the program set up. We've declared our variables. And so now in the next video, we can go in and start writing the logic of the program. Okay? All right, Spencer out.